Hello everyone, my name is Ritesh Pandey and in this video we'll take up isomerism in coordination compounds. Now isomerism in coordination compounds happens to be a very interesting, very important topic of our syllabus. All engineering entrance exams, medical entrance exams, plus your school board exams, there will be loads of questions from this topic of coordination compounds. Now when it comes to structural and stereoisomerism, it's very similar to what you do in organic compounds. There are two broad heads. Isomerism here could be either structural, where there will be structural differences between compounds, or stereo, where the term stereo, you know, means three-dimensional space. The term stereo means space. So in structural isomerism, you will have structural differences. In stereoisomerism, the structure will be the same. There will be difference in the arrangement of ligands in three-dimensional space. Like organic chemistry, in stereoisomerism, the two heads would be geometrical and optical. Geometrical isomerism and optical isomerism. In geometrical, we'll identify either a cis form or a trans form of a given compound. Optical, we'll talk about dextro. Remember dextro, D plus, which will rotate light to the right. Levio, L minus, which will rotate the plane of light to the left. And then there could be a meso compound, which you know will be optically inactive due to some element of symmetry. So there will be a lot of analogies from what you have done in organic chemistry. We'll want to begin with structural isomerism. In stereoisomerism, I'll tell you a lot of facts, a lot of inputs, a lot of tricks, which unfortunately is not there in the textbooks and sources around. So we'll want to go through all of this with a lot of excitement, with a lot of focus, and note down everything. We'll begin with structural isomerism. The first type of structural isomerism is ionization. Ionization isomerism. We'll also want to understand the terms very fundamentally. We'll want to identify the terms very fundamentally. We'll want to relate to the terms very literally. So, you know, I'll introduce the terms exactly in the manner how we differentiate the isomers. So, ionization isomers, we'll see, will ionize differently. Then the second type will be hydrate isomerism, where hydrate, water ligand will play a role. Third type will be linkage isomerism. Linkage, where the isomers will be differently linked using an ambidentate ligand. And the fourth type would be coordination isomerism, where we'll see the isomers are differently coordinated. So I repeat, you know, we'll want to know these terms, these types very fundamentally. We'll want to know these types very literally. We'll begin with ionization isomerism and we'll limit it to these four cases only, because these are the four popular conventional cases. Some books would talk about polymerization isomerism, linkage isomerism, coordination position isomerism. Those are pretty made up. You know, these four are, you know, the conventional and the required forms. We'll naturally begin with the first type, which is ionization isomerism, where we'll see the isomers will ionize differently, ionization. So once you've copied it at your convenience, you know, you'll want to copy it first, the broad classification, and then we'll begin with the first type of structural isomerism, which is ionization isomerism. I've already told you ionization isomers will ionize differently. Ionization isomerism, isomers will ionize differently. The first type of structural isomerism, ionization isomerism, you'll find isomers ionize differently. I mean, they produce different ions. They produce different ions on ionization. So I'll give you an example. There could be a compound like, suppose CONH35BrSO4. Let's call it compound A. And there could be a compound CONH35SO4Br. let me call it compound B. Now naturally A and B have the same formulae, but here A would give you sulfate and B would give you Br minus. So A would give you sulfate, B will give you Br minus, and because they give you different ions, you know, the one which is outside the square bracket will ionize. So this will give you sulfate, this will give you Br minus, and naturally they could be qualitatively differentiated. I hope you understand the difference between qualitative and quantitative estimation or differentiation. Here the quality of ions is different. So naturally A with barium chloride, because it's giving you sulfate, will give you barium sulfate, which is a known white PPT, insoluble in mineral acid, because sulfate is difficult to displace by any mineral acid, a white PPT, insoluble in mineral acids, and B, which will give you Br minus with silver nitrate, which silver nitrate will give you AgBr. Now AgBr is a pale yellow precipitate. AgBr is a pale yellow precipitate, and one fact very popular with AgBr is, AgBr is a yellow precipitate which is partly or sparingly soluble in NH4OH. Every time you have AgBr or Br minus given in a problem, AgBr always comes with an information, AgBr is a compound which is partly soluble in NH4OH. You will find AgCl completely soluble in NH4OH, AgI insoluble in NH4OH. And you will learn AgF, fluoride, will not be a precipitate, it will be soluble. So you know that's a very common way of differentiating between chloride, bromide and iodide. AgCl will be completely soluble in NH4OH, AgBr will be partly soluble in NH4OH, A and B can be qualitatively differentiated. I'll give you more examples. Again, you'll want to copy this, and I hope they are ionization isomers because they ionize differently. Obviously with the anion they'll give you the cation as well, but this will give you sulfate and this will give you bromide. They have the same formulae but difference in the structure, ionize differently. More examples could be I'll give you maybe one more example. There could be a compound like PtNH3 whole twice Cl2Br2, which naturally will give you Br minus, and there could be an isomer PtNH3 whole twice Br2 Cl2, which will give you Cl minus. Now if you call it isomer X and you call it isomer Y, how do you differentiate X and Y? This time this naturally is X, which will give you AgBr because it's giving you Br minus, partly soluble in NH4OH, and Y, the two have the same formula, but A will give you Br minus, Y will give you Cl minus. Now Y with silver nitrate, because Y will give you Cl minus, will give you AgCl. You know, it's a curdy white precipitate. This is the good thing about inorganic chemistry, it's absolutely specific. Curdy white means AgCl, plus it's completely soluble in NH4OH. They both form identical complexes with ammonium hydroxide. You have known AgNH3-2Cl or AgNH3-2Br, but this will dissolve completely and this will be partly soluble. So yet again, X and Y giving bromide or chloride can be qualitatively differentiated. We'll talk about the second type of isomerism now, which is hydrate isomerism. I think you're happy with this. Ionization isomerism, because they ionize differently. We'll come to the second part, which is hydrate isomerism now. Hydrate isomerism or solvate or solvation isomerism. Solvate for any other solvent. Hydrate is a common term because naturally it's water, hydrate isomerism, and isomers isomers will differ in the number of water ligands water ligands inside or outside the coordination sphere, inside or outside the coordination sphere. Yet again, in this case, there is a very popular example. A very popular example, you'll find a number of isomers with a common formula CrCl3.6H2O. It could be compound A, which will look like CrH2O6Cl3, compound B, which is CrH2O5Cl. You bring a Cl inside the coordination sphere, so naturally only two chlorine outside and water. There could be an isomer C, which is CrH2O4Cl2. So with two chlorine inside, there is one chlorine outside, H2O whole twice. They're different color as well. A would be violet in color. This will be dark green. It will be dark green, or you call it bluish green. I repeat, there will be some change in color. And the third one is, it's also called dark green. You'll want to call it bluish green, you know, because in B you'll have a tinge of blue. So this is called bluish green. There will be some difference in color, and now they could be quantitatively differentiated. Quantitatively, because the count of chloride ion is differently. 1 mole of A will give you 3 Cl minus, 1 mole of B will give you 2 Cl minus, 1 mole of C will give you 1 Cl minus. So A would give you 3 Cl minus, this will give you 2 Cl minus, and this will give you 1 Cl minus per mole. So A with silver nitrate will naturally give you 3 moles of AgCl. Naturally, if you take an excess of AgNO3, B would give you 2 moles of AgCl, and C would give you just 1 mole of AgCl per mole. I've seen problems, you know, where they put some numbers into the question. All you need to understand is the amount of AgCl from 1 mole of A, B and C. 1 mole of A, B and C would be in the ratio of 3:2:1, because A gives you 3 moles of Cl minus, B gives you 2 moles of Cl minus, C gives you 1 mole of Cl minus per mole. So they can be quantitatively differentiated. Now this giving you 3 Cl minus and a complex will give you 4 particles in all. B will give you 2 Cl minus and a complex would give you 3 particles in all. C will give you 1 Cl minus and the complex will give you 2 particles in all. So naturally the count of particles will also be in the ratio of A more than B more than C. So A more than B more than C will also be the order of molar conductance. You must have known, more the number of particles, more is the conductance. This will be the order of molar conductance. More number of particles, more conductance. In a topic like colligative properties, more number of particles will mean more colligative properties. Higher value of I, which is the Van 't Hoff factor. So they can be very quantitatively differentiated. A, B and C are called hydrate isomers because the number of water ligand inside and outside the coordination sphere is different. But both the cases we have seen so far are easy to differentiate. Either qualitatively or quantitatively they can be differentiated. We'll talk about the third case now, which is called linkage isomerism. You will want to copy this at your convenience, and we'll take up the third type, which is linkage isomerism. So we'll want to move on. Allow me to rub this, and we'll take up the third type of isomerism, which is linkage. Now in linkage isomerism, I told you we'll want to relate to each and every term very fundamentally. So linkage isomerism, I can write isomers differ in the nature of linkage. Isomers differ in the nature of linkage, nature or type of linkage with or to an ambidentate ligand. Ambidentate ligand. You know, an ambidentate ligand is one having more than one site of lone pair donation. We'll want to talk about the most popular example, which is nitro, where N donates the lone pair, and nitrito, where oxygen donates the lone pair. You know about ambidentate ligand. Suppose a very popular example could be CONH35NO2Cl2. Suppose this is compound A and you have compound B, which is CONH35ONOCl2. Now NO2 is an ambidentate ligand. I'll just write the structure here. NO2, either the nitrogen lone pair, you know, would be donated to the central metal and then it will be NO2, or the oxygen lone pair will be used and it will be ONO. You know what? Ambidentate ligand. So this would be involving nitrogen as the site of attack. This will be involving oxygen as the site of attack. Both will give you the same number of particles, the same type of particles in ionization. So for a change, first of all, you will want to know why the term linkage. Linkage, because they are differently linked to an ambidentate ligand, and they will be difficult to differentiate. For a change, they will be difficult to differentiate. They will be difficult to differentiate. You will want to deploy an ultraviolet or infrared or an NMR spectroscopy. Spectroscopy would tell you the type of linkage between the atom and the central metal. You can also use X-ray diffraction, but again, these are methods which are not in our syllabus. You'll just want to know them. But these are methods by which you can figure out whether it's nitrogen or oxygen. Suppose in this case, between compound A and B attached to the central element, linkage isomers are somewhat difficult to differentiate. You will want to have special techniques to identify the isomers. Before this, you know, the two were easier to differentiate. Now they are called linkage isomers because they are differently linked. So it will be nitrito. We'll see they are differently named in IUPAC nomenclature. It could be cyanide, isocyanide, thiocyanide, isothiocyanide. So every time you have an ambidentate ligand, there could be a linkage isomerism. We'll move to the fourth type, which is coordination isomerism. So again, you'll want to copy this at your convenience, and we'll talk about the fourth type, which is coordination isomerism. Now in coordination isomerism, yet again, very literally, I'll say isomers differ in the nature of coordination, between metals and respective ligands in complexes where both cation and anion are coordinate complexes. I can call it in compounds where both cation and anion are complexes. You'll want to note down this definition first, and then we can talk about a couple of very popular examples. Suppose it could be CONH36 CrCN6 and CrNH3 6 COCN6. Now this together is one compound. This is the cationic part. You would have seen this complex CONH3 6 plus 3, and you would have seen this compound CrCN6 plus 3 minus 3. So this is the cationic, this is the anionic part of a compound. See, you know, this is compound A. This is the cationic, this is the anionic part. This is supposed compound B, where CrNH3 6 plus 3 will be the cationic part, this will be the anionic part. You would have seen these complexes individually. But in this case, both the cation and anion, both are complexes. Cation be complex, anion be complex. And what is the difference? The difference is ammonia with cobalt, cyanide with chromium. Here ammonia with chromium, cyanide is with cobalt. So naturally the formula is same. You have the same pair of metals, the same number of ligands and type of ligands, but they are differently coordinated. So you know, I wanted you to know all of it very fundamentally. Ionization isomers differently ionize, hydrate isomers have different water ligands. Linkage isomers are differently linked, and finally coordination isomers are differently coordinated. You know, this is obviously specific because we deal with compounds where both cation and anion are complexes. I can give you more examples. I'm limiting it to only a couple of examples, you know, and trusting your intellect, because with only a couple of examples, PtNH3 4 plus 2, PtCl4, CuCl4 2 minus, you know, this is just one complex, this is plus 2, this is minus 2, I can call it compound X, and then there could be, you would have seen CONH3 4 plus 2, this could be the cationic part, and then PtCl4 2 minus is a very popular complex, where chlorine acts as a strong field ligand. You have known about this complex again. So here again, ammonia with platinum, chlorine with copper. Here ammonia with copper, chlorine with platinum. Naturally, we'll want to call them coordination isomers because they differ in the nature or type of coordination between metal and the respective ligand. So these are the four basic type of structural isomers. We'll want to talk about stereoisomerism in just a little while. Alright, so we'll want to resume our discussion on isomerism, and with the cases of structural isomerism dealt with, we'll want to begin with stereoisomerism. This naturally is going to be a longer discussion, will include a lot of variations and naturally a lot of learning as well. We'll begin with geometrical isomerism, and like organic chemistry, here the nomenclature will be cis and trans again. Although in organic chemistry, it was about restricted rotation around a pi bond or a ring. Here, you know, we would see it will be about again the arrangement of ligands in three-dimensional space. We'll again understand cis and trans as geometries, where in cis, you'll have similar ligands closer to each other in closer vicinity. Trans, where, you know, similar ligands will be away from each other. We'll talk about it, you know, gradually. But before we talk about geometrical isomerism in coordination compounds or complexes, let's take up cases where geometrical isomerism is not possible. So we'll want to begin with cases where geometrical isomerism is ruled out. Now, first and foremost, in coordination number 2 and 3. In coordination number 2, generally for sp, and 3 for sp2, there will be no geometrical isomerism. Because in sp and sp2, sp linear, the two arms at 180 degree, there are two bonds or two ligands, coordinate bonds, attached to the central metal. Now naturally these two are equivalent positions, there could not be any geometrical isomerism here. The same with 3 sp2 trigonal planar. So here again, if I have three arms, 120, 120, 120, 1, 2, 3, A, B, C, A with B, A with C, C with B, B with C. You know, the positions are equivalent. I hope it's understood. SP, SP2, there cannot be geometrical isomerism because the positions are equivalent. So when it's SP linear, SP2 trigonal planar, there are no geometrical isomers. Even in coordination number 4, SP3 tetrahedral, You recall a tetrahedral geometry? I did tell you. Tetrahedral is also symmetrical geometry. Tetrahedral is also symmetrical geometry. So now I'll need to hold, say, these four markers in this manner. And I've said this umpteen times in our discussion on chemical bonding. Every time I talk about tetrahedral, I tell you when it's an alkane or methane to begin with, carbon at the center, four hydrogen here. In this case, tetrahedral geometry is when you add all the, when you join all the corners. So it will give you a structure with four faces, tetrahedral. Now, if this is a tetrahedral geometry, I've said this in the past, I'm going to repeat it. Please listen carefully. A, B, C, D. Suppose if these are four arms, A, B, C, D. A with B, A with C, A with D, B with C, B with D, D with C, C, D with A. All positions are again equivalent. See, all positions are again equivalent. A with B, 109 degrees, 28 minutes. A with C, A with D, D with B, D with C. All bond angles are 109 degrees, 28 minutes. You can call it A, B, C, D, or you can call it A, B, C, D. Doesn't matter. So the positions are equivalent. How do you have geometrical isomers? When you know with an exchange in position, the two compounds have two different relative spatial arrangement. So in tetrahedral, again, because the four positions are equivalent, I guess you understand, tetrahedral, no geometrical isomers. So you'll have geometrical isomerism. You'll have geometrical isomerism neither in sp, sp2 or sp3 tetrahedral. It's going to be common in sp3, which is square planar, and obviously sp3d2, which is octahedral. Remember, in any case, we were talking about coordination number 4 and coordination number 6 more often in our discussion on coordination compounds. Coordination number 4 and coordination number 6 presents maximum cases. So naturally, we're interested in coordination number 4 and 6 more often. Coordination number 4, it's ruled out in tetrahedral geometry. It will be there in square planar complexes. We'll talk about coordinations number 6 as well. Let's begin with square planar complexes. In square planar complexes, there will be no geometrical isomerism. No geometrical isomerism for complexes of the type MA4 or MA3B. MA3B or MAB3 naturally means the same. Now, A3B would mean 3 of one type, 4th of another type. 3 of one type, 4th of another type. You recall the square planar complex. Square planar complexes, you have the metal at the center, and these are four bonds. These are four bonds. Naturally, if all the four are same, then naturally there can be no geometrical isomers. If there is just one different, you can put B here or here or here or here. Again, the position of B will not make a difference. MA4, MA3B, there will be no geometrical isomerism. I told you we wanted to begin with cases where there are no geometrical isomers. We will have geometrical isomers. We'll have geometrical isomers for MA2B2. Two of one kind, two of another kind, and MA2BC. MA2B2, there will be a cis form and there will be a trans form. For MA2B2, there will be a cis form and there will be a trans form. We'll see how. Now for MA2B2, allow me to draw these two forms. Either two similar ligands will be subtending 90 degrees between them, or the two would be subtending 180 degrees between them. Now naturally, this will be the cis form and this will be the trans form. When 2A subtend 90 degrees between them, they're closer, and when these two, they're subtending 180 degrees between them. You know, square planar means it's a planar geometry. The four are along the diagonals of a square. This naturally is called a square planar. And here we'll have a cis form where 2A subtend 90 degrees between them. We'll have a trans form where 2A subtend 180 degrees between them. You call in terms of A or B. This will look like the cis form. This will look like the trans form. For MA2BC, once you're done with MA2B2, for MA to BC, what I'll need to do is I'll just bring a C here. So this is MA to BC. We write again in terms of A, in terms of A, this is cis and this is trans. So this is cis and trans in terms of A this time. Previously it was cis and trans both in terms of A and B. But you will at least need just one ligand. You will need just one ligand which subtending 90 degrees will make it a cis isomer, subtending 180 degrees will make it a trans isomer, MA2B2, MA2BC. How do you identify, you know, these symbolic formulae with compounds? Yet again simple, MA2B2, it will look like a compound like PtNH3 2 Cl2. This is like MA2B2. Naturally, PtNH3 2 BrCl will look like MA2BC. So I think you are happy with this. MA2B2, two geometrical isomers. MA2BC, two geometrical isomers. In both of them, you'll have two geometrical isomers. You will want to continue this discussion, and we'll take up another example of square planar complexes. We'll take up another example of square planar complexes this time when say all the four ligands are different. Allow me to rub this. And now suppose we talk about a ligand where all four ligands are different. Now we talk about a complex where all four ligands are different. So now we take up a complex like MABCD. MABCD, a very, very popular case, a very, very important case. First of all, this will have three geometrical isomers. This will have three geometrical isomers. There could be a compound like this, or there could be an arrangement like this, or there could be an arrangement like this. How do you identify MABCD? Simple. It could be PtNH3 BrCl I. MABCD. When all the four ligands are different, how do you identify three geometrical isomers? You know, we would learn a few more facts in the next video, you know, because there are so many cases, I'll need more time and more classes to complete all of it. But any day, the different structures will be identified more precisely if we look at the trans arrangements. You know, we'll come to that. But when you talk about these three arrangements for a compound like MABCD, it will help if you understand that in the three complexes, in the first one, A is trans to D, in the second one, A is trans to C, in the third one, A is trans to B. So keeping one position constant, when it comes to the trans position, you have either D or C or B. And naturally, there are three geometrical isomers possible. There are three geometrical isomers possible. No cis, no trans. No cis, no trans because all the four are different. No cis, no trans because all the four are different. Like organic chemistry, you do not have an E or Z nomenclature here. So we do not go into that. Four different ligands, three possible arrangements. MABCD, and you would want to identify a complex like PT, ammonia, bromine, chlorine, iodine as a complex like MABCD, which naturally has three geometrical isomers. It has come in different exams in the past. You will want to know it exactly the way it is. Plus, you know, there could be a question like, in which of the following case there cannot be any cis or trans? Now, when there is a question like there is no cis and trans, it does not mean there is no geometrical isomerism. Remember, there is geometrical isomerism, three isomers possible, but no cis, no trans, because all the four are different from each other. Now, this is when we talk about normal square planar complexes. Next, we'll talk about a few complexes where you will involve bidentate ligand. Bidentate, you know, will have two lone pairs to donate, will naturally have two points of attachment to the central metal. Please note it very carefully. A limitation with bidentate ligand is, and you will want to note it down, a bidentate ligand, both the lone pairs whether it's a square planar or octahedral complex, you know, in the coming or future examples. A bidentate ligand has a limitation. A bidentate ligand, if suppose there is a ligand which is donating two lone pairs, it will always donate the two such that these two bonds are at 90 degrees. These two can never be at 180 degrees. It's a rule. These two will have to be at 90 degrees. It's a bidentate ligand. I'll use capital letters when I want bidentate ligand, and both the lone pairs will be attached to the central metal subtending 90 degrees. The two cannot be at 180 degrees. I've seen some very common mistakes in different books. You'll want to remember this. Now, I'll call it AA. I'll call it AA when it's a symmetrical bidentate ligand. When it's a symmetrical bidentate ligand, symmetrical bidentate ligand. Now, I'll give you a couple of examples right away. Symmetrical bidentate will be a ligand like oxalate. So both the lone pairs come from identical nuclei, the structure is symmetrical, or it could be ethylene diamine, you know about this, ethylene diamine. Naturally, these are symmetrical bidentate ligands, call it EN, this is C2O4 2-. So this is when it's symmetrical bidentate. When it's asymmetrical, the two lone pairs do not have identical surrounding, you'll write it as AB. I repeat, capital letters will mean it's bidentate, capital letters will mean it's bidentate, and AB will mean it's unsymmetrical bidentate. AB will mean it's unsymmetrical bidentate. So an unsymmetrical bidentate ligand could be a glycinato. So you have a CH2 to which you have NH2 and COO-. Naturally, it's an unsymmetrical bidentate ligand because the two ends, the two lone pairs, the two nuclei, and the overall structure of the ligand is not symmetrical. So this is an AB kind of thing. Capital letter will make it a bidentate ligand. AA means symmetrical, AB means unsymmetrical. I've told you about the limitation. Both the lone pairs, when donated or when attached to the central element, the angle will be 90 degrees. They cannot add, you know, at transpositions. This is a basic fact. Keep this in mind. And then we'll talk about ligands, bidentate ligands and the corresponding complexes. Allow me to rub this. So this was 0.6. We'll talk about 0.7 now. It will help if you take down the notes, you know, point wise, because the recall and the understanding will be better. So I'll call it 0.7 now. 0.7. And yet again, I'll talk about the cases where geometrical isomerism is not possible. No geometrical isomerism in naturally a complex like MAA whole twice N plus minus. It could be a charge positive, negative, whatever number. Or MAA A2N plus minus, or MAA ABN plus minus, because you know here, because the 2A would always be, you know, at 90 degrees with each other, the other two positions will be naturally at another 90 degrees with each other. So you know, you do not have geometrical isomers here. You'll have geometrical isomers, you'll have two geometrical isomers, you have two geometrical isomers for a complex like MAB whole twice N plus minus, or MAB AB N plus minus. So let me write MAB whole twice N plus minus as PTGLY2, platinum glycinato. You can have a complex like NH2, CH2, COO minus. Now naturally, this is a name AB, and NH2, CH2, COO minus. Now, this arrangement can be looked upon as, this could be looked upon as a cis form. because the 2NH2 and the 2COO- are naturally with the same arrangement. And you can have an arrangement where it could be PT NH2 CH2 COO minus and NH2 CH2 COO minus. Let me write COO minus here. So naturally NH2 above, NH2 below, CO minus here, CH2 minus, CHCO minus here. You understand? Similar ligands are subtaining 180 degrees. This is 180 degrees between two similar ligands. You will want to call it the transisomer. So this is MAB whole twice, where you know similar nuclei, 90 degrees or 180 degrees, you will call it a cis isomer or a transisomer. Two geometrical isomers here. And when it's MABAB, when it's MABAB, it could be like MAB, suppose A and B in this manner, where the two A, small and capital, are subtending 90 degrees, and here you can have another one. I'm again using A and B, small and capital, only for differentiation. It's not like this capital A has anything to do with this small a. Here there will be two possibilities. There will be two possibilities where either, you know, this capital A and small a are subtending 90 degrees or 180 degrees, but this capital A and small a might not be related. So here again, in this case, there will be two structures, but there will be no cis, no trans. I repeat, because they are not related here, you know, I'll call it cis and trans, because here ABAB, the two A or similar nuclei, are subtending 90 degrees. Here the two are subtending 180 degrees. So here we can talk about cis and trans, and these would be the cases of geometrical isomerism involving bidentate ligand. We'll talk about octahedral complexes now. I'll let you copy this at your convenience. I think you're happy so far. These are the cases involving coordination number 4. It has to be square planar. Plus, it's only geometrical isomerism here. No optical isomerism. Even if the four ligands are different, square planar itself is a symmetrical arrangement, planar arrangement. So when there is something, you know, served on a platter, on a plane, naturally there will be a plane of the molecule. So it's pretty planar, there is a plane of symmetry, and in square planar complexes, there will be no optical activity. We'll talk about optical activity along with geometrical isomerism in coordination complexes involving 6 ligands, octahedral complexes. And yet again, before I go into octahedral complexes, which can show geometrical isomerism, we'll talk about octahedral complexes where geometrical isomerism is not possible. So we'll begin with cases where we'll want to rule out geometrical isomerism. You'll want to copy this, and the next would be coordination number 6. Next would be coordination number 6. Now in coordination number 6, octahedral complexes, coordination number 6, octahedral complexes, let's understand the structure of octahedral geometry first. There is a central element, M, there are 4 in one plane and 2 in the perpendicular plane. I've told you these two could be the x-axis, y-axis and z-axis. So this 4 in one plane, one above the plane, one going into the plane. This is how an octahedral arrangement is going to look like. Obviously, there will be a pyramid above and a pyramid below. Coordination number 6, sp3, d2 or d2, sp3. You know about octahedral complexes, all angles will be 90 degrees. Now here again, we'll want to begin with cases where there are no geometrical isomerism, and naturally, there will be no geometrical isomerism for, suppose, a case like MA6 or a case like MA5B. You can also call it MAB5. because here all ligands same, obviously no geometrical or relative difference possible. 1B, you put it in any of the six positions. You remember what I told you in hybridization, sp3d2 octahedral. In octahedral, all the six positions are identical. It's not like sp3d trigonal bipyramidal where there are equatorial and axial positions. Here all the six are identical. Remember, in octahedral we do not talk about equatorial or axial positions. All positions are identical. So naturally, only one ligand different can take up any of these positions, and in these cases there will be no geometrical isomerism possible. There will be a geometrical isomerism in MA4B2, in MA4BC, and MA3B3. In all the three cases, there will be two geometrical isomers. In all the three cases, there will be two geometrical isomers. We would see the next possibility could be MA3B2C, and here you will have four geometrical isomers. Now MA4B2, two geometrical isomers will be in terms of B. You know, it will be in terms of B because with two B ligands, with two similar ligands, you can place the two B either at 90 degrees or at 180 degrees. I may not want to make it, you know, discontinuous. I might want to make 6 amps like this only, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. This is when they are subtending 90 degrees. This is the cis form, and this is when they are subtending 180 degrees. Naturally, the 4 are A. Naturally, the 4 are A here. So this is the cis form where the two are subtending 90 degrees. This is the trans form where the two are subtending 180 degrees. So this is trans, this is cis. The two making 90 degrees, I'll call it the cis isomer. The two making 180 degrees, I'll call it the trans isomer. Here cis and trans will be in terms of similar B ligands. The two making 90 degrees will be the cis form. The two making 180 degrees will be the trans form. MA4BC, it will be in terms of B and C. It will be in terms of B and C. So once you have copied this, if B and C subtend 90 degrees, it will be one form. And if B and C subtend 180 degrees, it will be another form. You'll have no cis and trans here again. You'll have no cis and trans here again, because here again B and C are not related to each other. You can't say it's cis and trans, but naturally the two different ligands would be either at 90 degrees. Doesn't matter you put B and C here or you put B and C here. You know, it looks like these are in the same plane, this two, you know, normally, but you know the positions are equivalent. As long as the two make 90 degrees cis form, B and C, cis and trans. This is trans, this B and this C will also be trans, but no cis and no trans here. MA3B3, and the two forms look particularly important. The two forms here, one is called meridional and another one is called facial. You'll want to remember these two terms. Obviously, you can identify a ligand like MA3B3 every time you have three ligands of one type, three ligands of another type. The two isomers are called meridional and facial. I'm going to talk about it. But yet again, when it's MA3B3, when it's MA3B3, there could be an arrangement where all the 3A are 90 with each other, and all the 3B are also 90 with each other. Now this is the facial form. This is the facial form. Any other arrangement will make it the meridional form. This will be the meridional form. So facial is when all the 3A are cis with each other, all the 3B are cis with each other. You imagine why it's called an octahedral. Imagine the six faces. When you imagine the base of a square, a face above and a face below, recall the six triangular faces which you have. In octahedral geometry, it's called octahedral because you have the base of a square, see a pyramid above and a pyramid below. Eight triangular faces. You know, A coming here, you know, you'll have four faces above and four faces below. Think about those eight triangular faces and you would realize that it's called facial and it's called meridional because when you have an arrangement where all are 90 degrees, all the 3A and all the 3B, there will be a face, you know, out of the eight octahedral faces. Listen carefully. You have the base of a square, A here, you know, here, A here would mean you have a face here. You have four faces above, 1, 2, 3, 4. Now, if A is here, there will be a face of this kind. There will be a face of this kind where all the three corners, A, 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 all the three corners of a face will be taken up by just one ligand. So it's called a facial isomer. So when you put all the three at 90 degrees, you see that all the three corners of a particular face, you know, which in this case is, suppose the face, you know, which is this one, you know, this one, the triangular face, 1, 2 and 3, this triangular face which comes out of the plane of the board, you have an A here, this A is obviously here, so all the three corners of this triangular face are taken up by A. Such an isomer is called a facial isomer because all the three corners in a face are taken by the same ligand. It's called meridional for a similar reason, and all of them will have some or the other element of symmetry because of which there will be no optical isomerism here. After this, in four geometrical isomerism, you will see that there will be one element of unsymmetry out of these four. One will have enantiomeric pair, and if you count that four geometrical isomerism out of which one is dextro, one is levio, so overall there will be five stereoisomers. Now it would take me more time and naturally maybe one more class to take you past all the possibilities, but what I'll do is before I end this class, I'll leave you with the numbers. See, I'll have more than a couple of ways of telling you about the possible structures, the different stereoisomers. I would be able to tell you using geometry, using the six faces, the six corners of an octahedral structure. Plus, there will be some tricks which I'll also, you know, discuss in the classroom, which will help you in calculating it right away in the real exam. But more often, the question is, they give you a complex and the question is an integer type question, you know. You're just asked how many geometrical isomers are possible, how many stereoisomers are possible. So what I'll do is, you know, at this point, towards the end of this class, I'll give you a table and I'll give you a couple of more tables in the upcoming videos where I'll give you those numbers. I'll ask you to somehow memorize these numbers because, you know, the explanation, the tricks would be only for your peace of mind. When you know the way of drawing all these structures, you're comfortable mentally. But this will never come in your school exam, this will never come in the board exams. All the possible octahedral complexes and drawing those structures would be like too much for a school or a board exam. But because it comes very regularly in entrance exams, I would give you a table covering all the possibilities. I'll begin with one involving monodentate ligands and you will want to remember these numbers somehow. We end up recalling so many numbers, you know. It's like the mobile phone numbers which we remember. So let me try if I can give you a table of that kind, and whether it's A, B, C, D or the different possibilities, I would be explaining the number of geometrical isomers and optical activity there at our mutual convenience. What I'll do right now is I'll give you a table of this kind because this will help you in straightforward questions where you only have to tick a particular number, or integer based question where you only have to write a particular number. So in your notes, you'll also want to have it in the tabular form. Suppose I give you the formula of the complex, number of geometrical isomers, number of enantiomeric pair, which means if at all there is chirality, and then the number of stereoisomers, the number of stereoisomers. So what are the possibilities involving monodentate ligand? You know, all possible formulae involving six monodentate ligands, there will naturally be complex like MA6, then MA5B, then MA4B2, then MA4BC, then MA3B3, then MA3B2C, then MA2B2C2, then MA2B2CD, then MA2BCDE, and maybe MABCDEF. It should be 11 in all. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. This means I've missed something. So if it is MA6, MA5B, MA4B2, MA4BC, MA3B3, MA3B2C, you'll have one in between which will be MA3BCD. It will be like MA3BCD. I'll want to give you a cleaner picture. So we'll want to draw it one more time. Maybe I'll use some more space in the whiteboard. And suppose we have complex geometrical isomer enantiomeric pair and total number of stereoisomers. So I'll want to give you all the possibilities, which are MA6, then suppose an MA5B, MA4B2, MA4BC. The markers are running out of ink at the wrong time. Alright, this is better. MA3B3, MA3B2C, MA3BCD, MA2B2C2, MA2B2CD, MA2BCDE, and this is MABCDEF. This would be 11 in all. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. You will notice there is a sequence which I have followed. And you will want to draw it in a tabular form. I'll give you another list involving bidentate ligands. And I repeat, it's like recalling a mobile number. 1, 1, 2, 2, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 9, 15. It's a very popular question. All the six ligands are different. Possible number of geometrical isomers are 15. And naturally, all 15, because the six ligands are different, all 15 will have no element of symmetry. All 15 will be unsymmetrical. All 15 will be optically active. 15 dextro, 15 levio would have 30 stereoisomers. I repeat, I'll explain all of them when the time is right. But it's not bad to have all of it written in one page. I'm giving you for the monodentate ligands. We'll talk about bidentate ligands in the next class. And I hope you end up recalling this as you remember a mobile number. So a particular sequence while writing these 11 and 1, 1, 2, 2, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 9, 15. 1, 1, 2, 2, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 9, 15. 1, 1 means there is just one geometrical isomer. I write 1 when I mean there are no geometrical isomers. See, if there are no geometrical isomers, the moment you have geometrical isomer, cis trans, it's 2. So, you know, I'm writing 1 here, I'm writing 1 here, because in these two, there were no geometrical isomers. 1 means there are no geometrical isomers. There is just one form, because the moment you have geometrical isomers, there are two forms. So, two geometrical isomers in this case, only one form, no geometrical isomerism. And this would be like 0, 0, 0, 0001122615. I repeat, you will want to end, remember it like a mobile number, 11222345 6915, and then 60000000112615. I'll tell you for the bidentate ligands also, 101101202202203. Now this is what I told you, out of four, if one is chiral, then out of four you'll have three which are non-chiral, and the fourth one chiral will be dextro and levier. 3 4 5 4 plus 1 5 5 1 6 6 2 8 9 6 15. If all the 15 for the last one are chiral, all the 15 chiral will mean all the 15 will be dextro levio, and overall there will be 30. If it's only a number which you have to write in the real exam, if it's an integer based question, although we'll take up everything in the upcoming video, you know, it's not a bad idea if you have a table written in this kind, in one particular page, you go through it so many times before the exam that you end up recalling it like a mobile number. 11222345 6915, 11222345 6915, then 0000000112615. So it will help if it's just a question involving a number which you have to tick, number of geometrical isomer or stereoisomer. We'll talk about it in the next video. This much for the time being. Thank you so much.